Hello, you're listening to The New Hampshire Show. My name's Joey, and I'm joined by Paul.
Good evening, mate.
And Neil.
Hey.
How fortunate are we now that we seem to support a club where a 1-0 home win against Chesterfield almost just feels run-of-the-mill?
About time, I think.
Yeah, I mean...
That'd be normal.
I'll tell you what is nice about it, though, is that it's now, what, are we 8 games in?
Yeah.
I can't... I mean, you're only ever, you know, one game away from a shit run, aren't you? It doesn't feel like it's going anywhere, though, at the moment, does it?
I was trying to look back to, like, the olden days. And by olden days, I mean, like, over the last sort of 15 years when we technically should have had a chance of promotion. How far have we got into a season without ballsing it all up? I always feel like we get to, like, mid-September and then, you know, we fall away from sixth or something like that.
Well, this
feels like we're taking a bit further.
This season's different. Well, this was going to be one of the only Quebec questions that I had, but I've left them anyway. One of the questions was going to be how many games into the season before we won our fifth league game of the season? And in obviously this is our fourth season in League One. Twice it's taken to like the middle of November or something for us to record our fifth win.
Wow.
Then do you add the Stephen Presley season where we were at Sixfields where I think we won our fifth game after 9 league games, and obviously this time we won our fifth game after 8 league games. But last season it was like 18 league games before we won our fifth game of the season.
That is depressing.
So and most people are sort of fine. Everybody's just like, yeah, it's still all right. He's still doing okay. He's just changing the team a bit too much by 18 games. Like, that's fucking rubbish. Stop winning games.
Oh dear. Right, should we do some moments of the week if we can remember what happened on Saturday? Paul, do you want to start?
We should have won 8 or 9-0. And the reason we didn't, and this is going to go against everything else you're going to hear in the pod today, where everything's going to be positive. Our decision-making in the final third was shit. And unbelievably shit at times. Like, chronically bad. And Jim O'Brien stands out for that. In the first half, he must have made 6 or 7 decisions which were just truly, truly woeful. And Ryan Kent, who again, I'm convinced we're going to talk very highly of, his decision-making in the final third was abysmally bad. Apart from one time when he got everything right and then he was let down by abysmal decision by the linesman.
Yeah.
But it's like one thing that sort of, obviously we're now quite a long way from the game, you sort of think back at it and you think, their goalkeeper didn't make, you know, normally if you have that much possession, you have that many chances, you're walking away going, their goalkeeper was man of the match. Their goalkeeper didn't have that much to do.
He made 2 good saves, didn't he?
Murphy's the one I'm thinking of. I can't think of any. What was the other one?
There was Murphy's. I think there was 2 from Murphy. There was the one that was very, very good that we were right behind, which was the one at his near post where he dropped down incredibly quickly. Then there was one other one that you made that I struggle to remember.
Murphy's long ranger.
Yes.
He had quite a decent, just bounced in front of him.
Not particularly spectacular. But you're right, given that we had... Did we have 28 attempts on goal? Am I just making that up? Or?
Well, we might have, but it was like 28% chances on goal, but almost like we had another 56 times where we, you know, that resulted from 56 good opportunities that we only had 28 chances on goal or whatever. It was... We wasted no amount of times when we were on 3-on-3. Or it was one point in the first half where I think we were sort of 3-on-2 and we contrived not to actually force the goalkeeper into a save. And I know it's all a bit contrary because we did play really well. But our decision-making in the final third, and I think this is where you realise just how good James Maddison is. You put James Maddison into that team, we do win that 4-0 because he just makes the right decision more often. And that's nothing to take away from a good performance by Kent or Murphy. It just shows how raw they are because Chesterfield was so open. They had so many times where they had the ball in really dangerous situations that, you know, it's good that they continue to try things. They didn't give up or just start hacking the ball aimlessly away. But it was just a case of you've got to start being more clinical. You've got to be better at this because other teams won't be as poor as Chesterfield were and they might hit us on the counter.
I completely agree with you about Maddison, but I'm worried that we've got to stop talking about him while he's injured at least, because we sound like we are like devotees, like he's our own religion at the moment. But I do agree with what you're saying. It's absolutely stunning the impact that he made in the 6 games that he played at the start of this season, because whilst I agree with you, I think we're going to talk reasonably balanced about the game when we come to it. And I think there was a lot of positives in there. And I think the negatives were something that sometimes just happens and come about for a number of reasons, which we'll go into. but that I can half agree with you when I think that if you put Maddison back in the centre of that, his decision making and overall use of the ball intelligently isn't quite there anymore. But that's not to say that we're lacking. Neil, what about you?
What are you asking me? Moment of the week,
yeah.
Oh,
right. Either you crack on. I mean, to be fair, I'm not going to pass over to you by saying maybe we need to calm down on the Maddison, and they'd go to you. Do you agree? Because I know where you're going to list it on that.
Probably the wrong direction. You don't want to encourage me.
I could feel your anger burning through the speakers.
No, I do have a theory on this, but we'll hit on that later on. My moment of the week's nothing to do with football, actually, because I thought we were going to talk a lot about that. So my moment of the week came at half time, and there was a bloke who was doing that kick it for a ticket thing. You know, when you kick it, I don't know if you go in for pints or whatever, but I sit there and I watch it. And he reminded me of me because he did what I would do. Well, you can just pass the ball into the net and that's great. He was trying to sort of loft the ball into the net and he got his penalty just about right. It sort of went in just under the bar. And I thought, hang on, this isn't going to end well for him. And then he went to the edge of the box. And then he tried to loft it again. And, you know, he sent it sailing over the bar. And I thought, yes, that was what I would do if I was offered the chance to do it. Because who wants to be the person who just passes it into the net? He was trying something clever. I think he's on Twitter. But I'm not going to name and shame him because he looked quite embarrassed as he walked off. But no, that was my moment of the week, actually. Him giving something different a go and fucking it up.
I've got to say, I'm very surprised because when you said he did what I would have done, I know that you, as I am, are a big fan of the toe punt.
Oh, and
I think that's exactly what I would do. And I think it's a pretty dangerous tactic, but it's the only way I can get any power on it, certainly. And even that's questionable.
You're definitely going to reach, aren't you, from halfway though?
I think so, yeah. I think you're going to go for the jet ski or the speedboat or whatever it is that you get from the halfway line.
I'm going to start entering a competition actually just to give it a go. What's that, Paul?
Then you get Bully's special prize.
Strong reference there.
Answers on a postcard as to what that might be for Cov fans.
In one.
Yeah. For me, moment of the week is going just to a man, I think, and that's to Reader Johnson.
Yes.
Partly, but admittedly only a small part, down to his performance on the pitch on Saturday, which I thought was really, really solid again, especially at the very tail end of the game where he bailed Chris Stokes out, but more for his sort of taking over from William Ejigwele as we love you Raider Johnson. First of all, the interactions that he had with Rob Jones. Hi Rob, if you're listening. So the video of Rob's kids that he responded to, and then the little sign that he got the lads to put up they were going to win, who they all looked pretty much like they were up for it. Maybe not so much with Jacob Murphy, though, I noticed. Sort of looked like he was going somewhere else and they were like, no, get back here.
Like, what is this?
It needs to be odd numbers for the correct sort of symmetry. You need that one in the middle, otherwise it looks a bit funny. And then, obviously, him saying about how emotional he was when people were singing his name towards the end of the game. It's just...
Oh, yeah. His mum was crying, wasn't she?
I think it could be easy to be a bit churlish and to sort of be like about it, but it's quite nice.
Well, there's just so many knobs around, aren't there? It's good when you've got someone who's, I don't care if it's pantomime, it's just nice to sort of have something to cling on to.
But I think it perpetuates further what feels like quite a positive feeling about the club at the moment, and God knows we need that given what we've been through over the last 150 years or whatever you want to call it. But it's certainly the most, I can't remember a time where the players have been so unanimously liked and the manager is. It's the long may it continue, I'd say. The only disappointing thing that I would say is, again, for 11,000 on Saturday, including nearly 1,000 Chesterfield fans, I do want to know what it takes people to get there. And I get that you can't go to every game, and I get that you whatever, but if you've complained all this time, and if you've been through the, like you, Neil, where you couldn't get to Six Fields and all that hurt and everything, and all the people that were so sort of emotional about it, come on, we need to get beyond the team now.
And it's worth it as well.
It's really good, isn't it?
But I think also, I think you got to put things in context. Basically, I think 11,000 would fill at least 8 or 9 other grounds in our division.
I'd probably say
and
more
some
than that.
Grounds it fill twice. I think Highbury Fleetwood's ground, I think, is only about 5,000. So I think, yeah, it looks worse because of the ground we're in. I think 11,000 at this level.
We just sort of know how many people
we can get.
There are
But also, I think, as you say, it's sort of it's slow burning, isn't it? I think the problem is we're still only in September, and there is still always going to be certain Cov fans who are going to wait and really see if things have improved. And I think I'd rather there was 11,000 there and we slowly build while winning, than suddenly have 20,000 there. And we don't win, and then you get everyone ringing at the radio going, same old city.
See, this is my issue, unfortunately. What have been the home attendances so far? We started as about 13-ish at Wigan.
But Wigan bought about 2,000, didn't they?
But okay, whatever.
They bought about 1,500. I think,
but it's, but it's, but it has, about the same. Well, I don't think it is. I think it's dwindled ever so slightly. And I think that, if anything, it should have picked up. If it's not picking up now, what happens if we go through a mini slump? I can see it tailing off. I just think there are 6-match packages. The season tickets are on pro rata. Even the tickets themselves are one of the cheapest in the league. More than anything, forget the financial side of it. Forget the it means we can bring another loan player in. We don't get very often when we're playing well. And I just urge people to come and have a watch of it at the moment, because I just think it's now's the time to come and watch us, because we're looking really good as far as I'm concerned.
No, I agree. I just think we've got to accept the fact 11,000 at this league, based on our history of the last couple of years, is not a bad attendance. When you think, I think the year after we won the cup, we were only getting 14,000. So 11,000 just isn't a bad attendance.
But I think that
and I think we should.
But I don't
it's,
think
it's one of those things, isn't it? It's like we can't win, can we? Because if we had 20,000 there and something went wrong, it'd be like. It's like at the end of the day, we're winning on the pitch. People will start to come, but we've had so many false dawns over the years. It's a case of by October, November, the people will start to come back, hopefully. I mean,
Neil, what do you make of it?
I sort of understand Paul's sentiment. I'm kind of in your camp though. I just feel like when it's this good, and I don't know how sort of infused we can be about this, it's really enjoyable to watch at the moment. I just feel. I always had it in my mind that if we were going well, everybody, regardless of the league, would all come back. And we saw last year, as soon as we went back to Rico, obviously big circumstances, but we got so many people turn up. And then it dwindled because the team wasn't very good. This is different. You know, it's a good team. And I just feel like people do. You don't want to miss out on this. And I don't feel it's not going to fall away as badly as it has done. We've got too many good players and there's too much of a good feeling about it. So people just need to turn up. And even if that nudges up to, you know, 13 or 14, that's more acceptable, I think. I mean, there's just something about 11. It just seems, even for us, it's just not enough.
Shall we move on to the actual game then? Neil, you're going to cut through it for us, isn't it? A really interesting game, I thought. Paul, you'd said that there was a sort of we were going to talk about a sort of mixture of positives and negatives. Neil, do you want to expand on that? What does that mean? What does that look in reality?
Well, I mean, obviously, it was a good performance, but a wasteful one, like Paul said earlier. I mean, and it was. I mean, I have my own theory, which isn't backed up by absolutely anything, but I do sometimes feel like when you have that many, it was almost that easy to create the chances. It just felt a little bit lax. It wasn't down to sort of, it was poor decision making, but it was just sort of almost lazy passes, and people, they didn't care about the margins as much as they maybe would have if they knew this was going to be their only chance to get the ball through. They'd be definitive with it. It was kind of like, well, we're going to get a chance again in a couple of minutes, so I'll just play it without any sort of thought. And it's those sort of passes all the way through the game, really. I mean, and I don't know which one of you picked out Jim O'Brien, but that, yeah, in the first half, certainly he was making some very strange decisions, and you can almost give him the benefit of the doubt because he's just coming back from feeling a bit iffy. But it was odd. But in his defence, him coming back was a positive. Again, it was one of those where there's something about Jim O'Brien, some inherent Jim O'Brien-ness when he's just the influence he has and the sort of the pace he plays the game at seems to rub off on the other players. And even though he wasn't playing well and he's doing all his manic passing and all that sort of stuff, I still feel like that has a good impact on the people around him. And it was good to see that we'd adjusted the shape slightly again. I mean, in the last few games we've been away, we've been very sort of one up front and there are a rigid group of people behind them. I almost felt like we were doing 4-2-4 again on Saturday. I don't know what you guys thought about the formation, but I didn't find there was any sort of defined striker at one point. I mean, it became that, but in the first sort of 10, 15 minutes, they were all over the place, all the players, I thought.
I think you're right. I think and we've talked about this earlier in the season, the fluidity has been absolutely crucial, hasn't it? And I think it's, again, our catchphrase of the redundancy of attacking formations, they're four intelligent players up there, aren't they? And so yeah, they can rotate around nicely. I thought there was a slightly more definition than you'd say, but I completely agree with you. Armstrong had got the ability to drop in and go wide if needed to be. And I don't think there was any massive definition as to which sides or centre the three of them were going to play at any one time.
Yeah, the only one I'd say probably did remain in the position was probably Kent.
Yeah,
he stayed in his number 10. He kind of, you know, picked that one up, and he's a little bit like Maddison in that he kind of doesn't go chasing for the ball, but the ball comes to him, and when it does come for him, you know, he's very forthright in the way he runs. I couldn't quite believe just how much he wanted to run with the ball and how sort of far he wanted to go with it as well. He's got like a really good turn of pace and this great knack of getting his toe to the ball just before the defender does, which seemed to be drawing in the fouls. And I mean, a few people sort of said it looked like he was playing for himself rather than the team. And I can quite kind of understand that. But to balance it out, I just feel like, you know, he's come from a youth team. He's had a lot of people telling him he's a good player. He's just trying to show what he can do. And I think over the course of games, he'll start to become more of a team player as he starts to understand the players around him and the sort of what they can do. I mean, like, I just felt like it was so open for him. He seemed desperate to score a wonder goal. And he's young, he's impetuous. And one thing we don't want to do is, like with Maddison, we don't want to stifle these people. Let them be the player they want to be. And he will gradually, you know, he'll adjust and attune to the people who are around him. But for now, if he's running and taking people on and doing good stuff, just leave him to it, and you know, and gradually he'll learn his lesson around, you know, in terms of making the right pass and drawing people in when he needs to. Just a note on Lemires was left out, which was the first time this season.
You called it pre-game, didn't you?
I did. I just felt like he was the one who was going to miss out just because of the games that had gone before. They've been a little bit trickier. We haven't played the same formation. He was struggling a little bit in terms of the involvement. I do feel like he misses Maddison, but he came on maybe for only 5 minutes, but already you could see the willingness to sort of, I've jumped really far ahead here, but the willingness to actually, you can see he wants to be back in the team, and he worked nicely with Kent. And so I'm sure he'll find his way back in the team at some point, but I think it's probably the right call just to drop him out, bring Kent into the team. Murphy had another great game. You know, he was just dominant on that left-hand side, really. And
grew into it enormously, didn't he? Yeah.
He seems to do that a lot.
Yeah.
He doesn't sort of start particularly quickly, but there's something about when the game gets stretched, and he carries the ball so well. And he may not be the greatest team player ever, but when he gets the ball, that's when he does the work for the team, because he does give them a bit of a rest. He's on his bike, and that one where he almost scored at the near post, that was, you know, that was cracking run, really.
Yeah.
But anyway, I'm going really far ahead. We missed a load of chances in the first half. Second half, we scored one, and it's Armstrong. And I was really pleased for him, because that was probably the least of all his chances, like the least clear cut one. He just sort of buggered up the control. And what was really good about it was just how he sort of adjusted. It was like the instinct to almost readjust his feet and stab his foot out. And it was just, you could see the relief in his face, really. You know, it was a high quality finish by a good player. I mean, you don't stab those in from there if you haven't got good feet. And it was just, I'm just pleased for him, because he's on about scoring hat tricks and all this when he got his first few goals, and he was like really keen. And it just feels like things got a little bit broken up when Maddison got injured and he had to go off on international duty and that sort of stuff. So hopefully this goal sets him off again and he'll be well on his way, because he does look a class above. He's not in the games as much as he was earlier on the season, but I'm sure that will come.
I don't care if he's got 6 in 7. I'm not suggesting that you were saying otherwise, but I think that there's something quite romantic to me about having quite an old-fashioned poacher up front who doesn't necessarily give you... And I think he tracks back okay. I'm not saying that he's completely redundant out of possession, but I quite like the idea of a player who is just literally scoring goals. He's up front. What I liked about his goal specifically on Saturday is, I think especially at League One and sort of Football League level, is that players have got a bit more of a tendency to want the comfortable shot. So they like to take an extra touch, or that they need to. And like you say, he quite spectacularly messed up his first touch when there was very little pressure on him. But that still the instinct in him was just to stab it towards goal. And I don't think he made a particularly clean connection, but I don't think the keeper was ready for him to just have a go that quickly. And I think
that's where he scored.
Yeah, he got foxed by it and couldn't get down quick enough, because I don't think many people would go for it after not. I think he had the time to set himself further and just thought, nah, I'm going for it. And there's a real killer instinct about him that I really adore. There was a moment after the goal, and this is utter supposition, but I'm going to be a fantasist about this, so I don't care. Where we won a corner pretty straight after we scored. And he was stood behind the keeper. He quite often takes up a position by the keeper when we have a corner, which I think is crazy, because I guess the idea is to try and put the keeper off by putting a large presence by him to try and sort of stop the run or anything like that. Instead, we seem to put Armstrong sort of like round him, like he might trip over Armstrong somehow.
We'll see him.
And Armstrong, we were right behind it. Armstrong had his arm round the keeper on a number of occasions and was like whispering in his ear. And I couldn't help but feel like he was just being a dick. Like he was just like, I just scored. Do you know what I mean? This'll happen again. I'm really good like that. It's complete. It's complete make-believe, but I'd love to know what he was saying to him if it's not. But like I say, I think there is something about him that I think was similar in our other recent god, Callum Wilson, of that you just feel like he's going to score. And there's like a killer instinct about him, like I say, that you just think, yeah, I'm going to back you. I think you're going to score goals.
You don't shoot from the halfway line with your left foot if you don't feel like you're better than most people on the pitch. And that in the first half was just...
Weren't as good as a Millwall one, fair to say.
Exactly, but it's almost like, you know, you do that once in a lifetime. You know, your left foot. It's just sort of like, that's a symbol of someone who really does think they're going to score all the time, every time they're on the pitch. And that's much better than what we've had before in previous seasons, when all we've had are strikers who are scared shitless of having the go or scared of missing. And that was something to do with the atmosphere as well. I'm sure there was like a toxicity about the atmosphere where people didn't want to be the one. They were all passing the buck. At least we don't have that now. I mean, we could do with making better decisions than we did the other day, but they were all trying to score themselves, which is different. And it's good, I think. I mean, it's better that you've got players all trying to... They're not scared to have a go, because you're going to have more shots, and lower averages suggest that you're going to score more if you're all going to... Everybody's going to be willing to have a bit of a go more often than not.
Paul, would you do me a favour and compare the goal that he scored against Millwall, his first... and the attempt that he made in the first half against Chesterfield. Could you possibly appraise those two efforts?
One was a great finish, one was shit. Yeah.
I was looking for bit flowerier than that, but I guess succinctity is your forte, isn't it?
Well, the thing is that it's one of those, isn't it? Everyone's I mean, at the end of the day, it was a woeful decision, because I think Murphy was completely free. And if he'd have just sort of made the shot slightly worse, it probably would have ended up at Murphy's foot. It went out for a throw-in. But, you know, it's one of those, isn't it? Everyone's positive. He scored a great goal earlier in the season. He saw it. He tried it. It was woeful. But we went on to win. He had a good game in terms of the fact that I thought he pulled defenders all over the park. And as you said, his first touch for the goal was absolutely horrendous. And it was amazing that Chesterfield had two centre-backs who were stood so far away from inside the 18-yard box that he had time to basically turn round, think about it and shoot. But he did hit it really early before the keeper had time to set himself. So the chance to sort of beat the keeper. But I don't know. It's fun. I find it really odd praising Armstrong because overall, he didn't get in enough decent positions to have, you know, he didn't seem to have that many shots. Maybe, as Neil was saying, maybe we didn't play the right pass and other people were trying to score. But I haven't read what Mowbray said, but I understand that he's said that he's not ready to go back to Newcastle. He's not the white knight that Newcastle fans need. And I sort of know what he means. I think
you've got to read that, by the way, if you've not read it. Neil, did you read it?
No, I only saw the headlines.
So he gave about 1,000 reasons why Newcastle should leave him here, but all the while sort of being like, and I'm not telling McLaren what to do sort of thing, but he was just like, you know, he's young and you've spent all that money on Mitrovic and it takes a long time for a £15 million striker to settle in. You're just like, yeah, we get it. You want to keep him,
yeah.
Fine.
He's just settled down in his flat.
But it's
he's just
like
put the kettle on. He's not going to go anywhere.
He'll have to cancel the paper.
But it's also one of those ones where it could make or break him, couldn't it? I mean, if he went back to Newcastle, got back in the first team, I think they're playing Sunderland soon. But I think they've got
Man United and really City in their next two games, haven't they? Or something like that. Yeah.
So if he went back, like, you know, if they pulled him back, and I think they're losing to Sheffield Wednesday this evening, so the clamour for him to return will probably increase. If he went back, scored in one of those games, it could set him up and he could have a brilliant career. If he goes back, doesn't score, gets sort of lost in Newcastle's system again for the rest of the season, which could happen, then it's all a bit of a waste, isn't it? I mean, I suppose if we were Newcastle fans, we'd be clamouring for him to come back.
It's so impulsive, though, isn't it? Because it's kind of like the clamour was there when he scored in the first couple of games, and then it went quiet because he wasn't playing and scoring, and then he scores one goal, and it's back again. And it's just like, even if he does go back and if he scores a goal, that may not make Newcastle any better. You know, he's just scored a goal and it might be good for him, but they could still be a losing team and there's no real value in it, I don't think, yet. Let him have a good season.
What I can't get my head around, and we're talking again in terms of we're guessing whether he might go back, but that I haven't noticed any marked improvement in him from between the first game of the season and yesterday. And that to me would suggest that there hasn't been an enormously marked improvement in his ability overall since they let him go on loan to us and now. And it would be remarkable to then reassess his position in the Newcastle squad, bearing in mind how many goals he scored in a League Two down, bearing in mind that he's still the same player that he was. It's not like they've all of a sudden, like he'd never scored before, and all of a sudden he's just hit the, you're like, oh wow, he's actually really good. He must still be either too diminutive or too, whatever it was that they felt had made him not ready for the Premier League yet. Seven games doesn't change that, does it? I think it'd be interesting to see what happens in January when the loan's up, because then if he's played 20 games and has scored 15 goals, maybe you'd say, if you're Steve McLaren, assuming you're still there, which at the moment I'd be quite surprised, maybe then it would be a decent thing. But I'd be very, very surprised. Like you say, Neil, it'd be incredibly impulsive to pull him back now.
But also, without one making a flippant remark, but I'm going to make one anyway. If he wasn't too diminutive, if he was too diminutive at the start of the season, he wasn't going to grow.
Well, yeah, you know what I mean. Well, I was using it as an example, but he could bulk out.
I understand that, but I think the case is that he's come to Coventry City to get games and score goals and build his confidence. If I was Steve McLaren looking at it, there is part of me that think, yeah, you'd call him back because it's going to give the crowd a lift and it's going to take a bit of pressure off you. It's going to give Armstrong's going to come back full of confidence. Even if he's the only confident player in the squad, he's going to come back buzzing because he scored, what is it now, 6 in 8 or 6 in 7?
Yeah.
So you're bringing back a player who is full of confidence, has scored goals, be it at a lower level, and you can then bring him out and sort of say, okay, we've listened to what people have said. You've complained, you've bitched, you've moaned. Here's someone on the pitch who's one of you. And he's that sort of player. He's all action anyway, isn't he? I mean, he's not like bringing back Jay Bothroyd, who's going to slope around the pitch, show a bit of magic here or there, but basically just, you're thinking, does he give a shit? This is a kid who you can see blatantly he's going to run around for you. And it, we're looking at it through Coventry City colour glasses, aren't we? We don't want him to go because if he goes, we might have to play Marc Antoine Fortune up front, which...
Which we'll come on to, because I know you're desperate to talk about his performance.
Yeah, well, you can call it a performance. I don't think I'll be that kind.
I want to ask Neil something else before we move on to Marc Antoine Fortune, as I think we've probably overanalyzed the Armstrong situation as much as possible.
Before we go on, one last question. If you were McLaren, would you call him back?
No. I really, like you say, without the sky blue glasses on, I really wouldn't.
Fair enough.
It's too early.
I think I would. I think McLaren's getting to that point now where he needs to throw something else at it.
It's not even October yet. He's had Mitrovic has been suspended. Maybe they just need a bit of time. Maybe he's not the right manager. Dare I say it?
Well, you can say that. I couldn't possibly.
You're listening to the Wee Lamptey Show, the foremost Newcastle and Coventry. podcast. Neil, I want to ask you about a certain Gaelic hero.
yes, ask me.
Romain Vincelot. Is that what we're settled on now? Let's just flip around it then. I don't think I can bring myself to say Vincelot without being self-referential. Talk to me about not only his performance on Saturday, but his impact on the team overall.
It was almost a bit of a sideshow because obviously the focus was all on the attack. But what he was doing in the middle against Morsi, especially in that second half, was really impressive. And I don't have too many specifics about what he did because I don't think it was about the specifics. It was just he kind of started to engage in a battle with Morsi, who was a good player. He was controlling and he was doing all... He was their enforcer. He was obviously their best player. And then... He seemed to get distracted. Vincelot started to join him in the battle, started to, you know, put himself in there, get some free kicks off him, start to get Morsi almost distracted from playing football into just getting into niggly tackles with Vincelot. And it worked. It showed a lot of nous by Vincelot because I felt like he knew what he was doing. He started to adjust the focus of their team from him being this pivot point to him just being this lunatic who was about to get sent off. And it was just Romain being... the ultimate pro, the ultimate control of the midfield, seeing what was going on, seeing what the issue was, seeing this guy was a good player and distracting him, turning him into this lunatic who was essentially pissed off because Vincelot was better than him. Essentially, he was just, he had his number by the end of it. He was just knocking the ball away from him, drawing fouls, and he was annoyed. And that was awesome. But it was almost the impact that he has beyond his own game. I think a lot of people have alluded to this, but the impact that he has on Fleck as well. Whereas last season, Fleck was almost a hybrid of roles. He was the Vincelot role, and he was also John Fleck as he is today. He was having to do those two things. Now his focus is adjusted. Now his focus is he's there to craft the attack, which is what you want from John Fleck. He's got a great pass on him. He's got a deceptive turn of pace. He's actually really quite nimble when he gets moving, and he can focus on that now, all because Vincelot is doing the right things in the middle of the pitch, like we've been crying out for God knows how many years.
I completely agree with you in terms of it being difficult to mark out any specifics from him. Me and Paul talked about it quite extensively on the way back. I think it's a mixture of anticipation and positioning, the likes of which we've not seen from a central midfielder in a long, long time, to the point where I really can't remember the last... you know, sort of defensive-minded midfielder that we've had of this ability level. And the second thing that I would pull out is I felt like, especially in the second half, Chesterfield were a horribly cynical team. Just very quick tangential point. Did anyone else notice, Paul, I know you did. Neil, did you notice the Sylvain Ebanks-Blake kicking out at Aaron Martin moment?
No, I mean, really, was
surreal.
Down your end?
Yeah, it was something of nothing where I think they might have had a corner that was cleared away or something. They were in quite a lot of space together and he just tried to kick him four or five times. Just they were stood sort of side by side and he was looking out towards the pitch and just sort of just tried to kick him really weakly.
Bastard.
Yeah. It was just, but it was, even if he'd have connected as cleanly as he could have possibly have done with each of them, I don't know what he was. It wouldn't have hurt him. It wouldn't have agitated him. It was a red card offence. Just five kicks, but he just didn't. It was just odd.
Go maybe on, Aaron Martin was just in his ear, just going, "God, you're fat. You're so fat." When you sit in a stand, everyone sat next to you. You're so fat, and maybe he was just like giving fat jokes all the game. Because if I was the next Ivan Lake, and let me ensure the listeners, I am a sort of very thin 18 stone, that Ivan Blake makes me look sort of the thinner one of the partnership. So I think if I was Aaron Martin, I'd just be in his ear all day just going, "How much did you have for breakfast? God, you're fat."
Well, at first I thought he might have been trying to kick Rolo wrappers that had sort of fallen out of his pocket down his leg and onto the floor. But then it was clear that there was intention on there. Anyway, I felt like the main point of their cynicism as the game wore on was focused towards Vincelot and Murphy. And I feel like it was a reflection of the growing influence that Murphy had over the game in that they couldn't really get near him pace-wise. Their poor right back had a real torrid time in the second half. And also the fact that Vincelot's sort of indomitable character never let them have the midfield despite their extra man, seeming an extra man in there at times. He still managed to be the dominant figure in there constantly, and they were just resorting to whatever they could to try and silence him. But he never reacted, apart from, and part of that, Paul will talk about it in more detail in a second, the point where maybe we don't need to get into this, as we probably analyse this to death in the car on the way home. He sort of reacted to try and get a player sent off, which I think he's probably within his rights to, but there you go. I didn't feel he looked like he was phased at any point, and he just got on with his game. And like you say, nothing spectacular, and I'm not expecting to see anything spectacular from him this season. But in terms of the dynamics of the team, I'm terrified of what will happen when he leaves. If he gets injured or suspended, because I don't think that team functions properly without him.
Absolutely. I completely agree.
Paul, do you want to talk about that?
Well, I think there's two players, I think, who are very, very good at wrestling the game.
Leave it there. Who are the two best players at wrestling?
Raider Johnson.
Yeah.
That's got to be one of them.
Yeah.
I think there's two good players who, when we're under pressure, are very good at relieving the pressure and getting us back into the game. One of them is Vincelot with his, as you say, he almost sort of identified their key player and the guy who could dictate the play, and then put him off the game and refocused him into having a one-on-one duel, which, yeah, I mean, we had a big discussion about this at the time. Basically, just after their player, what's his name?
Morsi.
Just after he got booked, he pulled Vincelot back. And he probably should have got a second yellow. And my argument for the fact he didn't was the fact that I thought Vincelot sort of turned to the referee and went, "You've just booked him. Look, he's pulling my shirt. Book him again." And I think if it had been any other player, I think he probably would have got sent off at that point. But because Vincelot, making a meal of it is probably not the right term, but he showed what had happened and basically told the referee to send him off. I think that saved him. But it's also, back in our day, you made five fouls and then you got booked. Now, you make one foul, you get booked, and then you get your five chances. And he may have had more than five chances, and he probably should have been sent off. But that's just the way it's gone, hasn't it? The other person who's very good at getting the game back in our favour is Jim O'Brien. And he was woeful in the first half, but I still think he had a good game. And he had a good game in the fact, I thought Chesterfield started the game really well. The first 15 minutes was probably their spell, and they got on top. But because of the way he plays, the drive he gives us, he's an outlet, and he's not an outlet in terms of holding the ball up particularly. He's just an outlet in, he drives us forward. He gets on the ball, he carries it, and he brings others into the game. And his whole dynamic makes the team play 10 yards further forward, which helps relieve pressure, because instead of the defence holding a deep line, they have to follow him up the pitch. And I said, he was shit, but he was good at being shit instead of just being annoyingly shit. If that makes any sense. Well,
no, it doesn't. But weirdly, as a Cov fan, yeah, somehow it does.
And I think that's why it's quite interesting. You look at the player reviews, and Kent got third or fourth player, like highest rating. And I found that he was more frustrating than Jim O'Brien was. over the entire game, I thought he made more poor decisions than Jim O'Brien did. But it just happened that that fifth, after they'd been on top, all the first major mistakes in their final third was Jim O'Brien. But it was interesting. It was always Jim O'Brien who was in that position to make those mistakes. And then the rest of the team sort of caught up with him and then sort of played better than him and moved on. But you need that guy who's going to wrestle the initiative back for us. And that's what he did without any end product.
Neil, have you got any final thoughts on the game before I let Paul have 15 seconds talking about Marc Antoine Fortune?
No, I don't. Actually, I do. I thought it was probably our best performance since Maddison got injured all round. I think it was the first time we looked like we didn't miss him from a sort of being able to create attacks point of view. We were a threat this time.
I think that's a fair point, yeah. Paul, I can count it down for you, but you've got a maximum of 15 seconds.
Well, do you want the short version or the long version?
Or the short version, please.
Okay. On Saturday, I felt sorry for Marcus Tudguy.
You've got extra time to elaborate. Go on. I didn't realise you were going to be as enigmatic as that. I thought the short version was going to say, I thought his passing was poor or something, but you can't leave people hanging like that.
Well, basically, Chesterfield were very open, and while I thought their final, not even their final ball, the ball which should have got them in decent positions before they released the final ball was lacking, they did have something about them. And towards the end of the game, they were getting in positions where they were quite dangerous. And we decided to bring on a striker to hold, one of the two physical strikers we have on the bench, either Marcus Tugai or Fortune. And for me, because of the match situation, I'd have brought Tugai on for the fact that he's done it in recent games and he is the player who's not only fit but in form. And when he brought Fortune on, it was a case of, okay, that's a bit unfair on Tugai because Tugai recently has been your go-to man who's really given the team that hold-up play that they've lacked. But if you're going to bring Fortune on, that's fine. And then Fortune was just woeful. And the worst one was where he basically tackled Murphy. And we had a 3-on-2, and then he held on to it. Then he held on to it, and you think, oh, he's going to shoot. Oh, no. And then he passed the ball 3 yards in front of Murphy and out of play, and then turned to Murphy and, why didn't you read what I was going to pass it? And you're like, because
he
doesn't understand why you tackled him in the first place. He doesn't understand why you're there on the pitch. Just leave him. And he berated about 3 plays. It's like, you've been on the pitch for 5 minutes. You've been truly fucking dreadful. And you're dictating, oh, just fuck off. God, and then he's like, I'm almost going to go down to the club shop and get a Tudguy name on the back of my shirt. That's how sorry I feel for the guy.
I would more say that's how contrary you can be.
Yeah, okay, that's fair enough.
Play the music, Joe. We're done.
Paul, I'll let you feel like the steam hasn't completely gone, but I would ask that it is the last bit before we move on.
No, it's just there's obviously he's better than that. He's got to be better than that. But so
Okay, then, let's do some Bury preview, shall we? We were talking just before we started recording, and you could turn this off right now and just think about what we were like 3 or 4 years ago, if you like, given the high numbers of ex-COV players in the Bury team. We correctly identified 6, was it last week?
Yeah.
And I was hoping that they were just the ones that played in their team and that they might actually have more, but it is just the 6. Peter Clark, Chris Hussey, Leon Clark, Danny Pugh, Nathan Cameron, Rhys Brown. A veritable mixed bag of previous players there, I would say. Quick straw.
Do they all play?
Yeah, regularly.
Wow.
Yeah, and we'll come on to... I did a little bit of research. I mean, if you can imagine such a thing, that extended further than just reading somebody's, you know, who's blog. on Monday, when we had our aborted attempt to record before Skype decided that it just didn't like certain people.
Neil.
Neil. Quick straw poll. If you had to have one of those players back, who would you have?
Leon Clark.
Neil?
Gotcha. Yeah, same.
If you had to avoid having one of them back, who would you choose?
Chris Hussey.
You're the 5.
Chris, has he Neil gone?
Dickhead, isn't he? All accounts.
Oh, okay. But not necessarily performance related.
I never had too much of a problem with him as a performer, to be honest. But you know, that's not, it's not all about the performance, Joey.
No, it's true.
He needs to be a good guy like Jacob Murphy.
True, yeah. And how lovely did Jacob Murphy sound again? He's running Chris Stokes close for loveliest lad at the club. So that's he's got to be careful. Paul, who did you say was the one that you'd have least?
All five.
The other five. You're just sticking to that.
Didn't really rate any of the other five. I didn't mind Hussey, but...
One of the interesting things about Bury is they have scored 15 goals so far this season, which makes them joint top scorers in League One with...
Adam Armstrong.
Us.
With your very own Coventry City, yep.
Yes.
The Chris Hussey thing was one that I wanted to have a particular look at because he was, in football parlance, much maligned during his spell with us. You know, again, it's another thing that you never hear anywhere outside of football, is it? But they seem to be pretty well behind him. He's created 5 goals this season out of their 15, which I think is pretty remarkable in itself. A lot of them were, as you would probably expect with that sort of assist record, suggesting that his crossing has notably improved either as the season's gone on or from last season if he was there, which I assume he was. But yeah, he seems to be one of their chief creators. Another one of their chief creators, Jacob Mellis, who is a player that I was quite surprised to see had sunk as low as Bury. I haven't fact-checked this for definite, but I'm pretty sure he was at Chelsea for a good while before moving to Barnsley.
Not sure.
And having a pretty successful spell at Barnsley when they were doing okay for a very brief period under someone. I'm sure we'll get tweets to confirm who the manager was, or whether, in fact, I'm just thinking of someone else, which is entirely possible. But I am pretty sure that he is a pretty flary, decent attacking midfielder who's created a couple of goals for them. They have got Tom Pope up front, who we were linked with about a million times over the last 2 or 3 years. A player who, for maybe Port Vale, I want to say Shrewsbury, but I could be wrong about that, put in one of the worst performances I've seen from an opposition player in recent years at Sixfield. A player who I didn't lose any sleep when we didn't sign eventually. However, he's made 4 of their goals this season and has... I can't remember how many scored. I've got it somewhere, but I'm not going to be able to find it in time for it to be worth it. Unsurprisingly, their top scorer is...
Leon Clark.
Yeah, one of his 5 goals came against Doncaster, where he was able to walk the ball back in. I don't know if anybody saw that.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Where that player scored... Was it effectively direct from a throw-in where he was trying to pass it back to the goalkeeper and then Leon Clark walked it back in? They're in 6th at the moment, although curiously they've only won 3 of their 8 games, but they've drawn 4. They've only lost 1 so far. They are doing pretty well form-wise, as you'd expect, but nothing groundbreaking. Won 3, drawn 2, lost 1. Home form, not quite as impressive. They've only won 1 of their 4 home games, but drawn the other 2. And on the road, we've won 2 and lost 2. That's my Bury preview.
Could I throw in a couple of things?
Yeah, of course you can.
They've got Ryan Lowe.
Oh, yes, of course.
Who I think he's older than me. Again, I'm 36, so he's old. They've got Chris Sedwick, who's also very old. They've got another Coventry City link. They've got Daniel Nardiello.
Oh, of course, yes. Son of Donato?
Yeah, who's a Cov fan and we've been linked with about 400 times. And my final thing is they've got the original Gael Bigirimara and all those sort of players. They've got Tom Soares, who went to Stoke for 1.25 million when he was about 16. And, well, now he plays for Bury, so that shows where his career has gone. So that's a lesson to you, all you youngsters out there. Don't sign for the first big club who comes along, otherwise you'll end up at Bury.
Now, is he Soares or is he Suarez?
Oh, please be Soares.
I want to say, isn't Suarez spelled completely differently?
Well, no, because isn't this is similar to Sebastian Coates at Sunderland.
Yeah.
I think I have a feeling, not that it matters in the slightest, I have a feeling he's Tom Suarez. But...
Well, we might as well call him Angel Suarez and say, yeah, that's how you pronounce Tom.
You hate all that foreign muck, don't you?
I just think if you're English and your name's Soares, you say Soares. But there again,
which every language, come on.
Okay, I think that's probably enough for Bury preview, unless Neil, you've got anything else to add?
No.
So why don't we do some predictions then before we go? Neil, what do you think?
Slightly worried, just because of all those players and Leon Clark. I still think we can get them. We could win it, but probably draw.
Paul?
I don't think that... I was surprised by how open Chesterfield were. And I know that, obviously, Bury have scored 15 goals, which would give the indication they're quite open as well. But I think it was going to be quite tight. I think it'd be... I'm hoping for a 1-0 victory, but I think it'll be quite a tight game.
Yeah, I should add that they've conceded 12.
Ah.
So they, yeah. I don't know if that influences your decision somewhat.
No.
Not 9-1. have you given a score?
Yeah, 1-0.
Oh, okay, sorry.
I can give the same score again if you want. 1-0.
No, that's quite all right. I think, again, I think it's tough to call. In the spirit of last week, where I mentioned that it seemed to be that when we predicted us to win, we lost, and vice versa, I'm going to go for a resounding 4-0 Bury win.
Solid.
Yeah, I'm now actually, and I'm not superstitious in the slightest, but I am now actually scared to make predictions until until this voodoo hex is lifted. Right. Have we got any other business before we wrap up?
A few more days to vote.
Oh, of course. Yeah. Neil, go on. Give the details.
Guys, we're for awards. Guys. So come on. You know, go to Sky Blue's blog, Twitter. You'll see a little link there where you can click it and you can tweet. Go to Neil Lamptey Show Twitter. See a little link there that you can tweet. Or go to footballbloggingawards.co.uk and there's a form. And vote for us, Neil Lamptey Show, as best podcast. And me, Sky Blue's blog, as best club blog. There we go.
Yeah.
Is that everything?
I think so, yeah. Don't forget Steve Phelps's book about the 87 Cup final is out. Neil wrote a fantastic review of it recently. You can head over to skybluesblog.co.uk to read that, and you can find out details of where to pick that up. And if you want to get in touch with us about anything, about constantly spamming your timeline with requests to vote for us, spoiler alert, they'll stop if you just do it. You can get hold of us at Neil Lamptey Show on Twitter or neillampteyshow@gmail.com. Thank you so much to everyone who's voted for us so far. It only takes 2 seconds to do it, but it really, really does mean a lot to us. We just want the glory. Just want some glory. Paul, have you got anything to add?
Glory.
Just all about the glory.
That's it. Once we've won, I'm going to retire on the spot. It's not going to get any better than that. Yes. Which is probably enough reason to make people vote.
Yeah. You just get up, pick up the award, drop the mic, and I'm out.
Yeah. My only concern is at the moment, Liverpool are drawing with Carlisle United, which means all the Liverpool fans will start going about Ryan Kent being recalled. So... come on, Liverpool.
For some reason, I thought you were going to say that they were going to suggest that Rodgers gets the sack and you replaced him, which I would have thought would have been quite a big leap.
Probably not. I'm probably not that far. Anyway, that's a completely different conversation.
That's for another day.
Yeah, which goes on something else me and you have discussed in the past. But I think Brendan Rodgers is going through the stereotypical about to be fired thing where he's just gone, oh, shit. I can't afford to lose games, so I'm going to start putting left backs on the left wing.
Doing a Strachan, as I think it's known in the business.
What I did like, sorry, complete tangent, but did make me chuckle at the time. Someone went, oh yeah, we should get rid of Brendan Rodgers and we should appoint Gary McAllister. And he were like, that would be genius. But that might stop either Sunderland, Newcastle or Villa being relegated. Liverpool being relegated or one of those three. Ugh.
Unless he's had great success in like the Qatari leagues or something unbeknownst to us. But I haven't noticed him doing a great deal of managerial work. I know he's there as a coach at the moment in the last 10 years or so. Yeah, it would be a bold move as far as I'm concerned. And Kenny Dalglish was such a roaring success, wasn't he?
Go on, Gary McAllister for Liverpool manager. Vote for that.
It's almost like some people haven't got a clue what they're talking about. Speaking of which, I think we should probably bring this to a close. Yeah, so thank you very much, Neil.
Glorious regards.
Thank you, Paul.
Cheers, mate.
And thank you, listener. Bye.